And now.
Dude, stop bouncing and stuff when we cue in.
Sorry.
Why do I have the countdown?
sorry. I just realized how off the camera was. So
okay.
Relax. Okay.
Every damn time.
Just chill.
You just have such a penchant.
Stop with the obnoxious words.
Oh, God. Never change. Except this one time, please.
Just give me a second.
Let me know when you're ready. Do your thing, man. Oh, my God. Hello, Mr. Tricorder. I can't stop laughing.
All right, let's do this.
All right, on the countdown.
Captain, incoming message.
It was the dawn of the third age of mankind. Groovy.
Hi-ho. This is me, Kermit the Frog.
Hello there.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
Not a great plan.
Oh, for crying out loud.
Program complete. Enter when ready.
Let's see what's out there. Engage.
Hey there, we're Those Sci-Fi Guys, and this is that Those Sci-Fi Guys show. Just two working dudes, different lives, different jobs, but a whole lot of love for science fiction and the fun that comes with. We are your hosts. I am P.S. McKay, more reliable than a new movie announcement from Lucasfilm.
And I'm D.T. Cavman, and almost anything is more reliable than a new film announcement from Lucasfilm. I mean, I think Indeed. That Australian text message you got was more reliable.
We do have listeners in Australia. I do want to point that out, but we are not ranked 110 or whatever it was. Like
210.
Was it 210? Yeah, we're not ranked 210 in that whole thing. So that was a nice fishing scandal. Anyway, how you doing, DT?
I am absolutely stoked, my friend.
Yeah.
I've been excited for this for a while. This is something that we tried to do. We tried to push for a bit, and damn, I'm excited. I got to admit, I'm stoked. And you know what? We've got a great show for you all tonight. We really do. It is our 200th episode.
Yeah, it is. Not only that, but it's on a very special date, very special anniversary date.
Right. Today is the 30th anniversary of the premiere of Star Trek Generations, the seventh Star Trek film, the first one to feature the Next Generation cast in a mild crossover with the original series crew, mostly William Shatner talking to Jean-Luc Picard.
Yeah.
Or Patrick Stewart.
Yeah, good point.
Captain of the Enterprise.
That's right.
Close to retirement?
I'm not planning on it.
Let me tell you something. Don't. Don't let them promote you. Don't let them transfer you. Don't do anything that takes you off the bridge of that ship, because while you're there, you can make a difference.
Come back with me. Help me stop Soren. Make a difference again.
Wait for it.
Who am I to argue with the captain of the Enterprise? What's the name of that planet? Viridian 3?
Yes.
I take it the odds are against us, and the situation is grim.
You could say that.
You know, if Spock were here, he'd say that I was an irrational, illogical human being for taking on a mission like that. Sounds like fun.
Hits home because today Michael Okuda also did a wonderful plug. Did a wonderful plug on. Did a wonderful plug on. Gosh, what were they called? Otoy. Thank you. I'm looking for. I sent you the link, which was just flipping amazing.
It's the Roddenberry Archives, is what. Is what they call these glorified fan films.
Well, and they're officially sanctioned. I mean, they're not necessarily canon, but they're sanctioned. And
they're approved by Rod Roddenberry and the, you know, estate.
Right. Toy.
Let's by the way, in this one, fantastic crossover.
Oh, yeah.
The body double.
Yeah. What do you mean? Who is the body double?
Sam Witwer.
Kenobi! What?
Maul, the voice of Maul.
Oh, he was? And he was the body double?
Did you not watch the credits?
No, I didn't watch them all. I mean, I watched some of it, but you're acting as if I'm supposed to remember people's names, dude.
That's what we do. This is our podcast.
I don't remember names. I'm trying to find Unification. I can't find it anywhere.
He is the voice for the Clone Wars and Rebels and then Solo of Maul. He had previously been Starkiller in the Force Unleashed video games.
That's right.
He was Crash Down in Battlestar Galactica, a recurring role early in the series. He's had prominent roles in other sci-fi shows. I think he was in Supergirl for a time. So, I mean, he's a legit actor, but also a voice actor, and his scream of rage for Obi-Wan Kenobi in the Clone Wars and Rebels is like his signature. And he was part of the Clone Wars panel that I went to at Rhode Island Comic Con.
There you go. Okay.
The downside is that everybody tried to get him to Kenobi, including James Arnold Taylor, the voice of Kenobi. And he teased us.
This came out today as a wonderful tribute.
So Sam Witwer is the body double, I guess, for this.
Yeah. That's amazing CGI. You can see this, right?
Oh, I saw it. Yeah.
You're seeing it now?
Yeah.
Just wonderful. And there's a nice little, we can't watch it all, but there's a wonderful cameo that comes up here. And Robin Curtis, everybody.
And I don't know who this Vulcan behind her is supposed to be, being all emotional.
I'm wondering if it's Sarek, make Sarek, or maybe it's her husband.
Now, pause here for a second. Now, I guess in the script of Star Trek IV, one of the reasons Savick stayed behind Vulcan is that she was pregnant with Spock's child.
Right.
Because she hooked up with Spock on Genesis.
Well, she did it out of necessity to keep him alive. I mean,
correct.
You know, but, I mean, it's just a thing. Like, she did the logical choice.
Right. But when you think about it now, as you get to the end of this 8-minute video, that being Spock's kid makes a lot of sense.
But he's dead? These are all people that have passed on.
I don't know. I wonder if this is like the Nexus or something.
I mean, a variation of it, maybe.
But how would Kirk show up if Spock was, if you know, Kirk was dead already? So there's definitely like some timey-wimey stuff going on here. It's fascinating. It's fantastic. I mean, well, remember, he was, there was the three versions. There was the early movie version. There was the classic 60s version. Then there was the Dead Man Walking.
Yeah, the Dead Man Walking. Yeah, all of them looked great. Like, they were just amazing, amazing digital art that was done there.
And I know they made a visual cue to the resurrection of the saucer section video from a year or so ago.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
But the Spock at the end of this video was much more like Leonard Nimoy than that. Like, they had made improvements.
Yeah, totally. Completely. Completely.
And one of the executive producers on this, in addition to Shatner and Rod Roddenberry, was Susan Bay Nimoy, Leonard Nimoy's widow. Mm-hmm. So,
all blessings, all the blessings, yep, all the right people were given and everything. So this wasn't a bastardization, and it was done beautifully.
It was. I really was fascinated why the Gary Mitchell piece. Not disappointed, but
he's watching everything.
But he's dead, that, right?
No. Isn't he out there?
No, Kirk dropped half a mountain on the side of him in that episode.
That's, Technically, that was him being possessed by Q, but whatever. So.
Oh, is that a fan theory?
No, that was from Peter David book.
Well, then it wasn't.
it didn't. I mean, not a fan theory, but it was in a book. I'm beta canon, but yeah.
Peter David's books were even in its own universe from the rest of the when Star Trek started falling in line.
Oh, I know. It was Q squared. It was the book Q squared. When Trelane was involved. Did you read that book? I mean, it was such an epic book. You would have read it. So.
Well, it's because you wouldn't stop talking about it. So I read it.
Sorry. I know I was an annoying kid back then. to be honest, I haven't changed that much. So
it dropped right before Generations, I think.
Yeah, I think it did. But let's talk about Generations real fast. It's not the main topic, but I just want to say you and I saw it together in the movie theaters.
We did.
30 years ago.
We were so stoked, and we were in line forever.
That was back when you had to wait out in line.
Yeah, couldn't buy them online.
Couldn't buy them online. You had to hope that you could get that there was enough, that you were there in line enough to be able to get a ticket for that next showing. Like, otherwise, you had to wait for another 3 hours and whatnot. There was no stadium seating. This was at this theater. It was the old one.
It was just an old movie. It was just a movie theater.
It was a movie theater of its time. I wouldn't say it was an old theater, but
no, it had, but like, it was 12 an old style comparatively.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it had like 12 screens.
Yeah. So
wasn't,
I mean,
much to look at.
Sound system was bad though in the right around 95, 96. They fixed it in 97 when we saw the re-release of the Star Wars special editions.
I believe we saw those at the new theater.
No, we saw them at the old one. Promise you. New theater didn't come out until summer of 97.
Yes.
Oh yeah, it would have been that time, but we didn't see it at the new theater.
I thought we did.
I know my memory is not what it used to be, but I remember like reciting to you Taoist examples of what Yoda was saying during Empire, and it was definitely during at the old theater.
I still don't think so, because I'm pretty sure that theater opened in 96, because I remember there being the Star Wars posters all over that place.
I mean, there were. Well, whatever. We're getting hung up.
That's what we do.
That's what we do. That being
said, we did it 199 times before.
This movie was made on speed. They filmed it in March and April. They had to do some reshoots in October, less than 6 weeks before the premiere. And you could see the difference in the rock formations between when Picard gets sucked into the Nexus and then when they get out of the Nexus and Picard reconfronts Soren with Kirk. The layout's different.
They had to reshoot his death scene.
Yeah, they reshot the death scene. And I was in the middle of reading Best Destiny by Diane Duane.
That was a good one, too.
That was a good one. It was like Kirk when he was a young kid and his first real. I bought that book again, hardcover, through Amazon recently. I haven't read it yet, but I'm going to. I'm excited to. I remember loving this film, but also being deeply affected by the death of Kirk. Like I was saddened. I actually made a shrine in my room to Kirk, and I couldn't finish Best Destiny. I was my second time reading it, so I already knew how it ended, but I couldn't finish that book because I was so overcome. It's like I didn't want to read about young Kirk after just seeing Kirk die.
In fairness, when he exited the Nexus, he was well over 100 years old.
Yeah. But from his perspective, it was just a few moments. So, you know, it is what it is. But it's funny because they never really, and this was done by design, but during all of TNG, they never really talked about Kirk's fate. I mean, obviously done by design, but it was always like an open-ended thing. Like, what happened to Kirk? I mean, he very well could have been alive during that time. We saw bones. You know, Spock was still alive. Scotty was because of the Enterprise. But
Scotty was, you know, that, you know, he didn't grow old there, kind of like Kirk. He got trapped and then pulled out.
They literally had the same fate. Like, interesting. What were your impressions of Generations?
I was stoked. I mean, I very much enjoyed it. Retrospectively, it was a good movie. You know, there were some people who wanted more oomph when you're called Generations and it's really 15 minutes of Kirk and Picard, you know, and you only get like a few minutes at the beginning with, you know, Scotty and Chekhov. There's no Spock. There's no Bones. No Sulu.
Yeah, it wasn't a trifecta.
No Uhura.
I think DeForest wanted to do it, but he was so frail the studio couldn't get insurance on him.
They wouldn't insure him, and I think Leonard Nimoy was basically like, if DeForest Kelly isn't in it, I'm not in it. And they were gonna
Leonard also said that there was no like purpose for him really being there. It didn't add anything to have him there. So
all the lines for all these other actors all ended up going to Chekhov and
Chekhov
Scotty,
is talking Chekhov about where's your medical bay? Scotty saying all this techno babble, which is actually written by a TNG writer. It didn't sound at all like Scotty when he was doing all the techno babble, like we can bypass the main deflector array to send power to.
Didn't Ronald D. Moore write Generations? Wasn't he one of the writers?
Yeah, him and Ira Bear, Stephen Ira Bear. No, not Ira Steven. Michael Piller. Michael Piller. Him and Michael Piller.
Well, it was a good movie. It was a good movie. It had gravitas. It was beautifully shot.
I agree. There were some nitpicks that I had even then. I know. I'm the king of nitpicks, right?
Yeah.
I could look past the uniform disparities. Like they just randomly were changing the uniforms in and out as they shot. You know what really bothered me? They didn't have the ship's hum in the background. The Enterprise hum. They didn't have that. Like when Picard was mourning in his quarters, it was dead silent. It threw me. Like the lighting was fantastic. We got to see it, 10 forward. I mean, that was different.
It was still too dark.
Well, yeah, that was when they started going dark, right? Like but they could do that because they filmed it a certain way for movies, whereas with television they had to film it would show up differently on the TVs, so
you still could have turned on a couple of overhead lights.
Well, they finally freaking did that in Picard season 3 at the end, so but yeah, I remember holding off on watching that movie Generations for over a year. I was at the mall. What? You're telling me to stop?
We've got to get going. This is not this episode.
Stop. We're moving on. Hold on. But I was at the mall and I saw the Star Trek Generations VHS behind the counter of like this entertainment store. Maybe it was Suncoast. And I remember asking, hey, how much for the thing? And he goes, $100. I'm like, what? Well, yeah, it's $100. I'm like, why? Like, this is what happened. Like, they would sell VHS tapes for $100 to the rental companies, like Blockbuster and other places. And then when you rented out the tapes, it would be... they would make that all that money they would get back through the rental fees. But for some reason, Suncoast was still quoting the wholesale cost of the tape. They weren't doing the retail thing. They just bought that one tape so they could put it on display. It was the damnedest thing. It irritated the hell out of me. Anyway, I didn't watch that movie for over a year, and then I finally got it on VHS. And I still had this the feeling like, okay, I don't want to overwatch this because I don't want to lose its specialness. Are you mewing me right now?
Dude, we're going too far down the rabbit hole on not our topic.
Whatever. I mean, we're done. I mean, there's not much more to add. I just wanted to add that little thing. What? It was another minute. It was literally another minute. Are we going to do this? Are we going to do this on the 200th episode? Is this how it's going to go? You already busted the opening the first time around. We had to do a second round.
Stop. Okay. Stop. All right. We have a big topic to cover and you just chewed up 15 minutes. You said we were going to do a quick cover.
And that is a quick cover. In a podcast that we normally have, I'm trying to say that we need to cut it down. And we cut it down to an hour and 20.
You're killing me, man. You're killing me.
Well, I'm just saying. Anyway, why are we here for today, sir?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, it is our 200th episode. And, unlike other episodes, milestone episodes where we either did a review of ourselves or sustains, improves, or best third season episodes, best 100th episode, we have decided that a huge moment like our 200th episode deserves a huge topic. And the biggest topic I could think of that we hadn't touched was the Peter Jackson Lord of the Rings trilogy. And it's topical because in December, the new Lord of the Rings animated movie War of the Rohirrim is dropping. So, without further ado, happy 200th episode, my friend.
Yeah, we happy 200th. Oh, that's what you wanted to do.
We are going.
You wanted to open your beer. There we go. Why did you just say so?
We have a huge topic to cover. Okay. If we were to try to do an episode on Tolkien, it would be like 8 hours.
Yeah. And this is really just going to be an amateur's review, to be honest with you, because I'm a fan of the books. I'm a fan of the movies. Hobbit. It's okay.
That's why I said, that's why I narrowed it down to the three movies, the Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
Not only were they excellent adaptations of Tolkien's work, and this is coming from a guy who is not what you would call a Tolkien scholar, and I do know that a lot of Tolkien purists had some issues with it, the way they either cut things down or whatnot, but again, these are almost three-hour movies that I think really captured the grandeur and the gravitas of Tolkien's work. And yes, you've read the book, so what do you think?
Okay, so I've written, I couldn't come up with 10 things, but I've written things that I liked about the movies and things that I didn't like. We're not going to be doing like recaps or anything like that, but
no, because at this point, if you're on this podcast,
you know
these.
You all should know by now. If not, edumacate yourselves, please. That being said, I first learned about the Lord of the Rings movies being made in the summer of 2000. And I had just gotten a brand new laptop for when I went to college. I was sitting in my room and I came across something about Elijah Wood being excited about, you know, working on Lord of the Rings and everything. I'm like, what? And there was a video featurette, and I did not have high speed internet at the time, but they did.
Very few teaser. People did.
I know. But they did a teaser featurette that I waited to have to download, where they showed, like, you know, Peter Jackson's being interviewed. He's like, you know, Lord of the Rings is just a very special. Now, I had heard of Lord of the Rings. I didn't know anything about it other than maybe seeing a couple scenes from the 70s cartoon.
Oh, my. The yeah. Hobbit. The 70s Hobbit was excellent.
70s Hobbit was good. 70s Hobbit was good. They did a Lord of the Rings version, which was like 40 minutes long or something, which they just truncated. It was awful.
But no, they did like a 2-hour and 30-minute movie that encompassed most of the Two Towers and the Fellowship.
Yeah. Okay.
And then they did another, whatever it was, 80-minute Return of the King that went back to the same style. They did different versions, but the Hobbit and Return of the King were very similar.
Yeah, I remember seeing...
It was the same animation and design and a lot of the same voice actors.
I did see parts of Return of the King, not knowing what it was, but I thought I recognized what Bilbo was, but it was Frodo at the time, so whatever. Peter Jackson was saying, you know, the audience has been begging to have this film made, but the technology is only now appropriate to be able to put this together to give reverence to the work that J.R.R. Tolkien did. And I saw animatronic orc face that I didn't know was an orc at the time, but it looked really good. They showed some examples of the CGI. So I'm sitting there. Hold on. There's someone at the front door. I'm not
kidding.
Well,
why don't I go ahead and continue? Go. So he can finish his story, but I tell you, I mean, I'd seen the animated. My cousins were huge Lord of the Rings fan, and so we watched the Rankin Bass and the Ralph Bakshi Lord of the Rings stuff from the 70s, and they were good. They were, you know, particularly The Hobbit and whatnot. They were very good. The Lord of the Rings by Ralph Bakshi was kind of strange. It was all rotoscope and a lot of dark. It was very dark, and you know, some of the characters just definitely, once you compare it to what you saw and even the other animated versions, it just seemed a little off. But they condensed two of the movies into one, or two of the books into one, and that was, it cut out a lot. But they were entertaining. The Hobbit, the Rankin Bass Hobbit, is considered a classic, you know, for kids. I showed it to my kid. She liked it. But, you know, these movies came out when I was in college. And, I mean, the trailers looked really cool, but I wasn't huge into fantasy. So, you know, I ended up going because friends wanted to go see it. And once I saw the Fellowship of the Rings, oh my God, I was hooked. Fantastic. And then, you know, I had to see the Two Towers. And then when Return of the King came out, I was at Fort Bliss, Texas. And
I was in Texas too, actually.
it was like opening weekend. And the theater, well, El Paso is a pretty big big city. It's like population like 500,000. So it had a big Cineplex, right? And me and a group of friends went, and I mean, the line was astronomical. Mm-hmm. I will say that we got pulled in line by some friends of ours who were farther up, and like, oh, hey, we were saving a spot for you, even though they kind of weren't, but they did us a solid.
Yeah. And this is before assigned seating, which only happened in 2018, 2019.
It was a little before that. If you know, once they started to do a lot of the more and more online booking, and at some of the bigger theaters, they would do that. But you're right, it's more and more prevalent only recently. But damn, dude. I mean, the fact that all three movies had multiple Academy Award nominations, mostly for, you know, visual effects and whatnot. But Return of the King won Best Picture, and deservedly so. It was fantastic.
Got a full sweep of 11 nominations, won all of them.
Yeah.
I feel like the Oscars knew that the Return of the King was going to be pretty epic. So they withheld the Oscars for the first two movies to give it to other movies. And they were basically banking for the Return of the King. I mean, that's just how Hollywood works and the Oscars work. Like, Halle Berry didn't win her Academy Award for that movie. She got it for something else. Like, Russell Crowe got the Academy Award for Gladiator, but it was really owed to him for The Insider.
Well, how about Leo? Like that.
And Leo, did he finally win something from The Revenant or something?
He won the Oscar for The Revenant.
Yeah. That was 10 years ago, wasn't it? Shit.
It was.
The Revenant.
Ian McKellen was nominated, though, for an Academy Award Best Supporting Actor in The Fellowship of the Rings.
Yeah, 2015. He was, and he did not get it. No. They withheld all the Oscars. Like, they got nominated.
And this is why the Oscars are so corrupt.
I know, but I think that they were just saying they're gonna do awesome with Return of the King. So don't even worry about it. Just, you know, just pretend that they're not, even though technically that movie was the best, Fellowship was the best movie made that year. That was in 01. Yes. And then in 02, the same year that, I was thinking of, Attack of the Clones coming out the same year as
Two Towers.
The Two Towers.
No, Two Towers did it better. The Two Towers were so much better.
So, Yes, I was pleasantly surprised. I did not see the first two movies when they first came out. I went to the discount movie theater during the summer. So those movies came out in December. And then during the summer, the following summer, I went to go see them at the discount theater for like $2. Still epic and amazing, but that's how I was. I had not read the books when I saw the first movie in the summer of 2002. Seeing the first movie made me want to go buy the books, which I did immediately thereafter. And then I promptly read all of them before the second movie came out. Now, here's the thing. I like to go through things we like and things that I struggled with. How shall I say that?
Sure. Why don't you go ahead and start with some of your likes? Lord knows that we're going to find out what you don't like.
Or do we want to start out? Do we want to start out? Let's end happy.
Fair enough.
Let's do that. Okay, so things that I didn't like.
And well, I got you made, dude. I'm going to end happy one way or another.
What is that beer you're drinking?
It's the same one I cracked for our 3-year.
Oh, okay. Okay.
The Chimay, the single bottle, nice. The premier ale. Nice. 8.5%.
That's pretty sweet.
It is.
See, that 8.5% will get you too. That sneaks up on you.
Sneak up more on you than me.
Yeah, well, I went to a brewery with a friend and it was just a beer, just beer. I only had 3 beers, but I was like, whoa, hold on a second.
Anyway. That I drink at like an exorbitant amount. It's just I've been drinking Chimay since 2009. Okay, so I know.
No one was implying that you. With it. No one was implying
just,
you have
just wanting
breakfast,
to make sure
so.
It's clear. You know.
So, no.
This is maybe the third Chimay I've had all year, so.
Yes. Okay, so let's go through things that I struggled with, and not necessarily that I didn't like. Okay.
All right.
I didn't know the geography. They went over the map with a quick passing at the very beginning when sure. they were doing the prologue and then explaining, you know, the wars and everything 3,000 years before whatever it was. So it was very hard for me to understand where they were going and why they were going through where they were.
Maybe it would have been good if they did the Indiana Jones map thing.
That's what I was thinking, right? Like they don't even need to be so blatant about it. Like you can see them traveling and they could just like transpose it over, you know, transparently. So you see both the map and them walking and traveling. That could have been easily done. But maybe as a device, it's looked upon as outdated, right? And also,
we are talking about things that are supposed to be thousands and thousands of years in the past, but right. Okay.
Right. Well, I can't tell you how much I studied that goddamn map when I was reading the book. Like, I would look at that map the whole time and then go and start reading and then go back and look at the map. I think Peter Jackson just was like, you know what? This is being made for Tolkien fans. The fans know the map. Those who don't know the map, it's not going to destroy the story, which it didn't destroy the story for me.
No.
It just left me a little confused or discombobulated, so to speak. I need to know where things are happening, right?
You've seen plenty of quests. I mean, did you? It was like the Princess Bride. They just wandered everywhere, right?
Yeah, that's true. That's true, so. But maybe they did the wrong thing by showing the map at the beginning, because then it was just biting, you know, eating at the back of my brain after that.
Fair. But again, that's a creative choice. Okay.
That was a creative choice. I mean, again, so, it's not, it doesn't detract from the value of the film in any way, shape or form.
Mm-hmm.
Frodo getting stabbed twice was weird.
Was it not in the book?
It was in the book. I didn't know it at the time, though. So it felt weird because in the book, it was more truncated. It was not truncated. I'm sorry. In the movie, it was truncated. That's going to be the word of the night, by the way. I'm going to stop using it now. But in the movie, it felt like it happened like 30 minutes before and, you know, 30 minutes apart, really. And it's like, he just got stabbed. He got stabbed by the Nazgul, right? And then he got stabbed by the cave troll. But he was wearing Mithril.
Mithril, yes.
In the cave, in not Zaha Doom.
Khazad
Doom. Khazad Doom. I knew I was close.
But if he was in Khazad Doom, you could have run into John Sheridan.
That is true.
Zaha Doom.
Yes, exactly. They're right next to each other. They share a border. In Khazad.
Yeah, it's in the Dooms.
Yeah. By the Doom, it's in the Doom neighborhood.
The Doom of Valeria is there. Doctor Doom.
So with that being said, sorry, my dog's here. He's pretty docile right now, but so I felt that was odd. So as someone who didn't read the book, he literally gets stabbed twice in the same area. That's a little weird. That felt off.
Reminds me of that episode from season 4 of Lower Decks where they're like, all the women go end up at an Orion bar and Mariner keeps getting stabbed in the same spot. It was a good one.
Yeah, that was a good one. I like that.
Well, I mean, okay. So, but it was in the book, so.
It was in the book. I just felt it was weird. Maybe it could have been played a little differently. I felt that Aragorn.
But if it was in the book, you know, if they didn't do it, the purists would have been on it.
I know, right? Yeah. So, and I'll be explaining that in a second.
Let's move on.
I felt that Aragorn and Boromir were overpowered against the Uruk-hai. Like these were big, massive beasts, right? Like huge, like hulking machines. And Boromir and Aragorn could slice and dice right through them.
That's because they were trained.
Are you saying that the Uruk-hai weren't? And they just relied on brute force or something?
Yes.
It was interesting.
I mean, when you think about it, most of them were just pulled right out of the ground, like days, maybe weeks before. And like, yes. You've got, I mean, granted, this is mysticism and magic and all sorts of, you know, strange powers in here. But Boromir for starters, Aragorn's like almost 90, okay, because he's got the blood of Numenor in him. So he lives much longer than most mortal men.
I didn't realize that.
They do bring it up. I think it was in the books, but it was in a cut scene from Return of the King. If you watch it was in the extended cut of the Two Towers. And I think if you watch the extended version, the scene is in there.
I mean, I own the extended versions. My son.
That's all I own are the extended versions.
That little bastard. That little bastard watched all the extended versions without me. Like, I'm so mad at him.
Well, my kid and I watched the first two, but we haven't finished it. And she wants to, so we're going to, but
you know,
to watch Return of the King. But I only did when I had to rent it off of through Prime. I only did the extended version. I wasn't going to skimp on it.
No.
Even though if you watch the non-extended version, the original cut, they're great movies. I just think there's a bit more in the story that can be told. And if you're sitting at home watching, you can pause. So.
Yeah, that's true. I agree.
Again, but Aragorn has been a ranger for like 60 years or more, okay? He grew up at times under the elves. So, I mean, he's extremely skilled. Boromir has basically been fighting a war his whole life. You know, so these are very experienced, trained warriors. That's what I took it as. When you see them pulling the Uruk-hai out of the ground, like days before this fight goes down.
This is true.
I didn't think it was too overpowered.
I just, it, it, I found the Uruk-hai to be so overwhelming cinematically that as an observer, I'm like, holy crap, how are you going to fight that? And they did. And they showed it convincingly, by the way. It's not like we're seeing Captain America pulling a... Yeah, that's true. I mean, Boromir was killed trying, and everything. But it's not like we're seeing America pull down a helicopter or anything.
That was pretty cool.
It was still pretty cool, don't get me wrong. But, they were still within human limits. I wasn't expecting how well they would handle themselves with the Uruk-hai. I remember these are just visceral feelings that I had watching the first movie. Sure. So it's fine. Again, these are like observations that I had as an uninformed fan.
Sure, right? Of course.
So,
and apparently Aragorn in the books was a bit more, he was a little less humble from what I've seen. That Viggo Mortensen kind of downplayed. He kind of did a little bit of the I don't want it, Jon Snow shit at first. Apparently Aragorn always wanted it, at least in the books. I think he was a bit more, I'm not going to say brash or arrogant, but more open with his desire.
Yeah. Interesting.
But Viggo Mortensen just crushed it. And and he was a late addition too, wasn't he?
He was. Like, he was one of the last people casted. So,
but they had cast somebody first, right?
That I can't explain. I can't.
It's hard to argue. I mean, he was outstanding.
When did I buy the entire series of Parks and Recreation? Shit. Damn it.
So apparently Patrick Stewart was considered at once for the part of Gandalf. And while one of their casting directors was reviewing a tape of him acting opposite Ian McKellen, they suggested to Ian McKellen, or they suggested Ian McKellen to Peter Jackson, who was then his choice. And I saw a clip recently of Christopher Lee, who actually knew Tolkien and was actually Tolkien's choice when he was younger as Gandalf. But I think Christopher Lee's history kind of played a little against him. And he said, he interviewed and they're like, we really want you for Saruman.
Mm.
And since, he's a horror legend, he really did bring that menacing visage to Saruman.
Yeah.
I mean, it was Christopher Lee is just fantastic. might be one of the most interesting people I've learned about in a long time. When you do like his personal biography and learn that he's like a descendant of Charlemagne and connected to all sorts of royalty on the continent and in England. And he's Ian Fleming's cousin, and he served in World War II with some mysterious background and actually was teaching people on the set of Lord of the Rings sword fighting and shit, and told Peter Jackson what it sounds like to be stabbed.
God. that's macabre.
Well, I mean, the man did get a lot of run in horror movies.
Yes, he did.
He's a hammer horror legend. He was Dracula.
Yeah. Say hi to Tucker, by the way.
Hey, Tuck, how you doing?
He can hear you too. So,
well, anyway, I tell you, buddy. That was and the casting was fantastic. I didn't have any problems with any casting.
I didn't either. I didn't either. You know what? no, keep going, because I do have a gripe about another thing.
Go ahead, finish your gripe. Let's finish the gripes.
So we have Sauron, who is the main antagonist, right? And then Gandalf runs off to his wizarding, you know, guild or whatever to seek his
order. The
wizarding order. And
it's not Harry Potter.
To seek guidance. I know. Well, there's no guild in Harry Potter. It's houses. But to seek guidance from his mentor, Saruman.
Correct.
But he turns out to be a bad guy, too. So we have Sauron and Saruman. And I'm sitting here going, those sound too similar. It bothered me. It was hard for me to especially for someone who didn't read the books, it was weird. Because I'm sitting here like, oh, this is the guy we need to worry about, right? Like, this is the guy who had the ring and wants it now.
I almost wonder if the name Saruman was chosen by Tolkien to foreshadow
his evilness,
his eventual alliance with Sauron.
Well, I'm sure that he chose the S sound to do that. Unnecessary.
Hey, you go back in time and argue with the linguistic genius.
Hey, I'm going to tell you a little secret. Every bad guy in my book, that's human, has a sound. No, it starts with a cuss sound.
Oh, hard K sound.
Hard K sound. So
well, you're starting to sound like Raj when he goes to meet Stan Lee in Big Bang Theory.
Yeah,
and the alliteration. But it makes sense. It helps you remember these things, right?
Right. Right. So I thought that was funny. So did we ever really know what Gandalf's power was?
Beard?
It was never really defined. Like Tucker. Okay. No more.
Nobody. I mean, did.
I'm listening, by the way.
The wizard's power is, I mean, if you remember all the way back in The Hobbit, he's extremely mysterious. He kept popping in and out, right?
Yes.
Gandalf in Lord of the Rings
is
a
Gandalf
bit
the Wise,
more
wasn't he?
Gandalf the Grey.
Yeah. Oh, and then Gandalf the White, but yeah.
The Wandering Wizard, they called. That was a nickname.
And he had a talent for fireworks, which was established in Fellowship. Okay, fine.
I am
Gandalf. We saw him ward off.
Gandalf means me.
Yeah. We saw him ward off the flying Nazgul, protecting Faramir's.
Faramir's, yeah.
Men, which was cool. I liked that. He fended off the Balrog, but it was still nebulous as to what that power was. And in the book we learn that there's the blue wizard.
There's two blue wizards. Who are off somewhere in the east, and you really don't hear anything about them. They're just mentioned. Then there's Saruman the White. Right. There's Saruman the White. There's Radagast the Brown, and there's Gandalf the Grey. There was only five Astari that went to Earth, and this is, or went to Middle Earth. This is stuff
and they
picked
came
up
from the
during
sky,
deep
right?
dives. They're the Maia. They're sent by the Valar.
They came from the sky.
They came from the gods, yeah. They're like minor deities or something. Were
demigods.
Sent to, yeah.
Tucker.
In some ways, they almost seem to be like angels.
Yeah.
Sent to guide, but then one goes Lucifer on him.
The one. Oh, my God. Okay. You're gone. Sorry. Let's go. Come on.
All right, you're gone. All right, folks. It's just the DT Kathman show. Anyway.
I'm here. So
you sure?
Sorry, I had to put Tucker outside. He's going to scratch
him
the door
in the
for a minute.
Place.
Well, he's a loving dog. He doesn't want to be without me. So.
Yeah, I know. And that's fair.
Oh, there's a couple other things.
Well, let's get through them.
The third movie, the theatrical version, cut out the death of Saruman. That was inexcusable.
And I believe that wasn't that actually from the Two Towers book?
It was in the Two Towers book, yes. And so they pushed it off to the third movie. Well, and then there's a wizard in there still. It's like most of the things that they cut out, I felt were healthy cuts. They were fine. Sure. Like I didn't have very many issues with what they cut out in the first two movies. The third movie, though, many
people when the first movie came out were so pissed that there was no Tom Bombadil in it. Who's just a very weird character.
Who was that one?
Tom Bombadil?
Yeah, please refresh my memory.
He's like Gandalf's smoking buddy, the guy who like won't be corrupted by the ring. This is all he's all at the part beginning of the Hobbit's journey.
Oh.
Again,
oh, that's who he ran into. I thought he was. Yeah, they were sitting on a fence and they were smoking for a little bit when Gandalf was doing research on the ring. Interesting.
So yeah. That was cut out. All of that, yeah, the Barrow Whites, all this stuff from the adventure of the, and they also trimmed down when Bilbo leaves to when Gandalf comes back to Frodo. It's like literally almost 20 years.
It's 30 years. It's a 30
I thought it was like
gap.
17.
No, it's like 30 years. Like it took 30 years to research the ring for Gandalf. He went all the way to Minas Tirith and back. And then
if he had just taken the fucking eagles.
But he was searching the land for, you know, he was going through all the different libraries and everything. So and I remember, and I mentioned this in a previous episode, where Frodo stopped aging as he possessed the ring. He stopped aging.
As did Bilbo.
Yeah. And because of that, people in the Shire started looking at Frodo a little differently, going, oh, it must be in the family that they don't age or something. Like he was being actively judged by the Shire. So
they both were.
I know, but it was mentioned in the first book when I read it. But yeah, not having the death of Saruman in the third movie was a crime. It was a crime. Now it's remedied in the extended version, but they just gloss over it in the theatrical version. I'm sitting here going, oh yeah,
they're saying
he's still alive. Like the end, Treebeard says there's a wizard still in the tower up there, and then Gandalf's like, yeah, how about that? Oh, there it is. Here's the Palindrir. I'm off. Bye. It's like, I understand why they had to cut it the way they did. The movie was 3 hours and 30 minutes. You cannot have a movie in the movie theater that is longer than that. You just can't.
Yes, you can. I went to see one. It was called Gettysburg. It was 4 hours and 20 minutes in the theatrical cut.
Yeah, and how much
money
did it make?
Two showings. Not a ton.
Exactly.
Very well received. Huge on video sales.
Sure.
And is widely considered a very good Civil War movie.
Yeah, but
and a very well done movie in general. Not as much, but Ted Turner didn't need the money anyway.
I'm just pointing out they can't, you if you want to make a lot of money in the theatrical run, which is where they make their money back, you can't have it be more than 3 hours and
well, if it
minutes.
If it's super long, then you have less showings.
Yes. Well, that's the problem. And you also have to have an intermission. If it's over 4 hours, like
Gods and Generals was 3.5. That was its prequel. And I want to say they did an intermission at an hour and a half. But anyway, carrying on.
That was the only thing that bothered me. But the thing I loved. So, do you have any things that bothered you?
I haven't gotten into it. I want you to finish your shit.
Okay. I'm all done. I'm about to go on the good things. So why don't you do your thing now?
Having not read the books before I saw it, I don't have much to compare it to. I mean, do would I, having learned more about it, would I have liked to have seen the Gray Company, particularly in Return of the King? Because that's actually who arrives at Minas Tirith. The dead men help them take the ships, and then they're released. It's like Aragorn, along with some reinforcements from Southern Gondor and the Gray Company, that show up. According to the books.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
But yeah, it would have been cool to see some of these Rangers. You know, they keep talking about them, and it's only Aragorn you see in the movies. You know,
this is true. I felt that the it did feel like getting the ghosts of the men was a little rushed. Kinda. Like it,
yeah.
A little Deus Ex Machina, if you will.
Hey, look, it looked cool.
It did look cool. It did look cool. By the way,
I'm not gonna argue.
Practically a perfect movie, by the way. Trust me. I mean,
all three of
I'm
them.
I'm just, yeah, all three. Practically perfect.
We're talking
in
like
every way.
90, we're talking these movies are like 95% or higher.
Yeah. I mean,
well done.
I'm not shitting on this movie just to shit on it. I'm actively looking for something to try to talk about here, because it's not like, hi, Kiss rules. Ah, good answer. Good call, guys.
<You know? laughs> It's okay to have positivity about these things, man. It's okay to admit that you don't have much other than...
We haven't gotten there yet.
Yeah, but you had like 10 things that you wanted to gripe about.
It was 6. I added the 7th. It was 5. I added a 6th.
I know that one of the big gripes people had was elves at Helm's Deep.
Oh, yeah, they didn't
I have
show
no
up in
problem
the
with it.
Yeah, I had no problem with it either.
I actually like it. That. I think it makes the, and I know that it's supposed to be transitioned to the world of men, but I mean, you have one elf, one dwarf, and that's really it. Come on, man. You've got hundreds.
You've got to show that it's a more active world than that.
It does feel better. Now, granted, while this isn't technically in the main stories, in like the appendices, I guess, they talk about the battles. And Erebor and Dale against, I think they're Easterlings, and Sauron's forces trying to take, you know, the kingdom of Erebor, the Lonely Mountain, you know, Dane Ironfoot, King Under the Mountain, and the grandson of Bard, and they fight against they fight against Sauron's forces there. There's whole battles and campaigns going on in other theaters of the War of the Ring. You just don't see them in the movies. It's all written in like the appendices and stuff that Tolkien wrote to accompany the Lord of the Rings. The stuff he didn't put in the main story. But I mean, it is fascinating. I mean, you hear about, you know, you hear all these legends and stories in the movies about elves and dwarves, and all you really get for the most part is Legolas and Gimli, plus, you know, the occasional elf here and there, you know. But I did like elves at Helm Deep. I know it wasn't in the original story. I just thought it looked cool, you know. It made it seem a little less hopeless for a time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, there's also all like the Ents and the Hurons that like go and wipe out what's left of the Orc forces after the Rohirrim arrive at Helm's Deep. You in the extended cut of the Two Towers, you do see. As the orcs are streaming away from the battlefield, you do see like the trees start moving.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you don't really get much more than that. They cut it out of the theatrical cut. But if I had my way, especially the way I like watching movies, you know, give me the extended cut. Put an intermission in, sure. But give me the extended cut in the theater. I will go see the 4-hour movie.
You are not. You are not the public, sir.
I know. I'm just saying me. And this is my podcast. This is our podcast. So this is what I get to say.
I'm actually nervous about it being able to make time to see Red One. So.
Same. Know, like... It can be a pain in the ass. But. I mean, I love that shit. It was. And what I really enjoyed is the storytelling motifs. Cate Blanchett doing the brief intro, whatever it is, 3 to 4 minute intro of the history of the ring.
Yeah, that was good.
The fight with Sauron. It was very good.
It was effective. It sold what the whole thing was about very well. And I'm like, oh, Bilbo Baggins. Oh, yeah, I know who Bilbo is because I remember the cartoon. You know.
Yep. And I enjoy Ian Holm.
Yeah, he was great. He was a great Bilbo. That's what bothered me about
Martin Freeman.
Martin Freeman, thank you. That's what bothered me about Martin Freeman.
I liked him as Bilbo, but at times they sidetracked him in his own movies.
They did. And
that was my issue.
The Hobbit movies have their own issues, trust me. But we're not going to go into it very much here. But I liked Ian Holm. I was loyal to Ian Holm as Bilbo. So,
and he was in it.
Let me ask you, when Frodo meets Bilbo at Rivendell.
Yes.
And he was, oh, let me see the ring one more time. And Frodo's holding it, I don't think so. Fuck. And they do and his face morphs. Like, do you think that was necessary? I don't know. Like, first of all, you know, I think Frodo undersold that. Like, he should have freaked the Moor out about that face change.
Yes. He should have been a little bit. But that creeped me out.
It was very creepy. I jumped. But, I'm not going to lie.
Yeah. But I think that was designed to hammer home the point of just how dangerous this is. And Bilbo resisted this for quite a long time, when you think about it. I mean, yeah, he might have been a little douchier in his old age than maybe he would have been if he didn't have the ring. Sure. But he was also much longer. And they say that the hobbits seem to have a stronger resistance to the evil of the ring because of, I don't know, maybe their simple life.
I think it's the simple life, and they're hardy folk. They're hardworking folk. Like they're set in their not set in their ways necessarily.
They don't have delusions of power and grandeur.
Correct. They just want to provide for their family and have a nice life. That's it.
They want to drink ale, simple ambition, smoke their pipe weed, and
yeah.
Yeah.
Simple ambition, and that's okay. You know, shit, that's all I want. Except for the weed. I don't want that.
My asthma's not great. Ales and good food and, you know.
And the company of good friends and family. Yeah.
Yeah. I could rock some Hobbit lifestyle. Yeah. I'll tell you that much.
I've got the feet for it, so. That's right. You're about to throw up. So,
for me, what I loved it was that they did not overly rely. I mean, sure, some of the battle scenes really, in order to show the grandeur, they did have to rely on CGI, but they didn't overly rely on CGI. When you think about it compared to the prequels in Star Wars, which are going on right at the same time, and how they went too heavy with CGI, particularly in episodes 2 and 3.
Well, that was Lucas's, like, you know, experiment. That was him. Those are his experimental films, in
which
a sense.
And I respect that, because he wanted to do things in 1977 that he didn't have the technology for.
Right.
And he created technology back in the 70s.
Yeah, they created
even beyond what they did.
They created motion blur for stop motion animation. Like, I mean, Jesus, that looks great. Like
that's the original special effects of the original Star Wars. Even in, it still hold up pretty well.
Oh, it's, comparatively, yeah, exceedingly well. Mm-hmm.
But aside from some of the huge battle scenes, for the most part, these three movies really relied more on
practical effects
and visual effects. That was something that The Hobbit got wrong. They went to CGI too.
They rely too much on CGI rather than having CGI accent the effects that they had.
Correct.
Which is what... That's how CGI needs to be used. It accents the scene. It doesn't create the scene. That's the rule, guys. Right? That's the rule.
Yeah.
The Hobbit was... I mean, The Hobbit just created its own physics, by the way. Like... Legolas jumping on falling bricks, you know, to push him up higher. Like, the barrels going down the river. Like,
well, the river was in the book. Like, the whole thing with Bomber, like, bouncing up and over, that one was too much.
Yeah, but in the Lord of the Rings, it was done perfectly. What was it? I feel like with Gollum that they first of all, he wasn't really prominent in the first book. Okay, so that was their excuse. I feel like that they needed to wait another year to get Gollum right, which they totally did. Like, we saw Gollum in the darkness. We saw him, the eye shine, which was amazing, by the way. That was so well done.
You're confusing his name with that of the ancient spirit.
Gollum. Sorry.
Yes.
Gollum. You know who I'm talking about. But yes. But the eye shine, can you agree that the eye shine was fantastic? That was layers and layers of CG.
No, right there. It was really good. And you didn't see him, you saw a little visual things, you saw, you know, the torture scene, but only from a distance.
Mm-hmm. But in the second movie, because I was getting vibes of like a Dobby the elf from Harry Potter, a Jar Jar Binks from Star Wars. Like, you knew they looked like CGI. Like, but Gollum
really looked good.
He was integrated exceedingly well. You got to give hats off to that. I mean, it still looks great today in 4K.
Well, that mocap stuff that Andy Serkis did was fantastic.
Oh, Weta. I will say that Weta is the far superior effects group to Lucasfilm any day of the week. Lucasfilm started it, but Weta perfected it.
Well, yeah.
So, but that was one of my big likes.
But the costuming, the weapons, the designs was fantastic. Like, when you go back to the if you just look at the 1977 or the 1975 The Hobbit, and you look at the elves in there, they were almost buggy looking, you know, very spindly limbs and weird. Mm-hmm. And the dwarves, well, I mean, they all kind of looked like gnomes, you know, with the hats and whatnot. But the elves in Lord of the Rings in these movies, they looked like ethereal, you know. I mean, it looked like Hollywood, you know, tall, blonde, pretty. Most of them.
Yeah.
But they all looked tall and slender, but fit and elegant. You know, these look like the children of gods. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Which is what the elves were, right? The chosen. And then the dwarves look like they come right out of the ground, but they look like they're ready for a fight, you know? Not like the seven dwarves from Snow White, like they did in the Hobbit cartoon.
Yeah. Good Lord. By the way, it was fun to see humans fight. The Uruk-hai, it was fun to see them fight the orcs. It was fun to watch. Battle for Helm's Deep. Probably,
was a fantastic battle scene.
What was amazing. It was amazing. Sorry, my dog's going nuts. I'm hearing my family like freak out over him right now. So anyway, Battle for Helm's Deep, amazing. The way they started it up with the psychological warfare with the Uruk-hai marching in, and they take their staffs, their spears, and their all typical stuff that's done, you know, in warfare, you know, since time began, right?
Medieval warfare.
Yeah. And then the rain, tink, 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 just that impending moment of the flood coming. The rain was representative of the Uruk-hai standing there in front of them, that deluge of just misery coming at them. It was so good. So well done. I don't even remember if it rained in the book, to be honest with you. Like, but and then the kids, like, I mean, you had 14-year-olds, 10-year-olds, not 10-year-olds, but 11-year-olds putting on armor and stuff. Every able-bodied young man.
Most have seen Too Many Winters or Not Enough.
Yeah, yeah. That was. I remember I was watching it with my wife. It was the second time I had seen it, but my wife's first time. We had rented it, and she saw that, like, one of the kids getting chainmail, and she's like, "Oh my god." I'm like, yeah, that's called an existential crisis right there. That's what happens. Like, just.
That's what happens when your entire way of life is, you know.
On the brink.
Under siege.
Mm-hmm.
And, exactly. The battles you saw, I mean, aside from the mostly CGI battle you see at the beginning of the Fellowship of the Ring, all the battles are really just with the small fellowship fighting against groups of orcs, right?
Yep.
So they're small fights.
And it was in the woods. Yeah.
The woods and in the mountain, right?
Yeah. But that was in the dark too, in the mountain.
Well, it was at least well lit in the chamber that they were fighting.
Yes, true. Anyway.
But those were small scale, really skirmishes, fights, really. You don't get to see the major battles until, you know, you get to Return of the King, or the Two Towers. And that's where they introduced Rohan and the Rohirrim, which... By the way, the designs of these costumes and these armies, particularly the armies of men and elves and dwarves, it's just so fucking good.
So, little fun fact, this is all filmed in New Zealand, which we all know, but because the epicness and the scale was so grand, there was a chainmail shortage worldwide. And they were making these things from scratch too, to supplement and everything. And also there was a nationwide horse shortage in New Zealand because they were all being used for the movies. Now, how do I know this? Because at the same time that they were filming Lord of the Rings, they were also filming Jack of All Trades. And the horse they got for Bruce Campbell was like a second rate horse and stuff. Like it took a while to find it and
Nutcracker.
Yeah. Nutcracker. And he wasn't that well trained and everything, but they had to make do with what they had because Peter Jackson had all the other horses. So, that's a fun little nitbit, fun little bit about Jack of All Trades. So
I love that show.
Good show. Can't play it. We will be copyrighted pretty thoroughly. Now, if it was just the audio show, yeah, I'd play it all day. But now we're really relying on YouTube now because our viewership is pretty healthy.
You mean we still can't play the audio?
We can't play the audio. We can't. Ooh. I mean, it's gonna be copyrighted. I mean, it just won't work.
Ooh, how dare you? You deprive us of our Jack.
All I'm saying, yeah, thank you. all I'm saying is, do we want our 200th very important episode to be copyrighted so that only we can see it?
Hell no.
Exactly. Damn
that
right.
Being said, I do love, you know, that show. Yes. But the acting was so well done in this movie. It literally made careers for so many actors. Viggo Mortensen could do anything he wanted. Ian McKellen was just continuing this rise that started with X-Men.
Yeah.
Because he was filming those in between, you know, around these too. Right.
The first movie I ever saw him in was the HBO movie And the Band Played On, which was kind of like a...
About AIDS, wasn't it?
It was basically, yeah, a retelling of the CDC and everything coming across, discovering HIV, not even knowing the name of it. Like they had to come up with the name and everything. But that whole telltale. But Ian McClellan played an activist out of San Francisco. I know. I misspell his name all the time. Whatever. Ian McKellen.
There you go. I think the first movie I saw him in was Apt Pupil, which was a short story by Stephen King. Oh, yeah. King.
Came out in 99. I read that book. Yeah. I didn't see the movie. I read the book, though.
It was fucked up.
It was fucking dark. It was fucking dark. Yeah. I mean, he cooked cats in the book, at least. I don't think they showed that in the movie.
And there was Ross.
Huh?
David Schwimmer was in it. He was like the high school principal. He was such a yeah. Thief.
How can you take David Schwimmer seriously in a role like that?
And then he went to Band of Brothers, where he did great.
Yeah.
He was such a dick in Band of Brothers.
I didn't see Band of Brothers.
Yeah, and then I saw him as Magneto and then as Gandalf. And I liked him a lot. Yeah, I mean, he was great in both roles, but you got to like Gandalf.
I feel like they needed to delay Lord of the Rings because he was filming X-Men. It was something along that line.
I mean, there might have been some delays, but whatever.
Anyway,
he crushed both roles, and he was amazing because he could be big and blustery. Or he could be kind and guiding and
soft
strong. And he killed it. Just the perfect performance. You know, and when you see him squaring off against Christopher Lee, a man who's a living legend, and it just, even though you know who he is, he just sinks so much into this role. And you feel this like 50 years of horror movie coming out at you. That voice too, it's the voice. You know?
That, oh yeah.
Frodo Baggins, do not tempt me.
No, I was talking about Christopher Lee.
Oh, damn it.
No,
he was good too.
Ian McKellen did do that. Bilbo Baggins, I am not trying to rob you. You know, that's, you know, where they use the power to, you know, expand their voice or whatnot. Like when they hear Saruman's voice on the wind when they're trying to cross the mountains, you know.
Yeah.
And he's kicking up that storm. It was just so good. I mean, you have Viggo Mortensen, who's both humble and strong, and Boromir, who, I mean, Sean Bean always Sean Beans, you know. He always brings that, you know, that grit to a role, right? But he did the, he was cocky Ned Stark, you know. Yes. But what I love, especially when you see his flashback in the Two Towers extended scene, is the misgivings he has about going to the Great Council and about leaving the fight and just wanting to defend his people and the and loving his brother. You know, it's just,
yes,
when you look back at Boromir, he's a very tragic character because he's a man who really wants to do the right thing. He really wants to just protect his people.
His intentions are pure, but he redeems himself. I don't want to say the term weak, but
he's desperate.
Yeah, his desperation is his Achilles heel, and it leaves him vulnerable. He's vulnerable. That's what I was looking for.
Yes, but he goes out like a straight boss. He does his best. He realizes his mistake, and he tries to redeem himself. And he goes to defend, you know, Merry and Pippin, and goes down like a boss. Like he's like murking freaking Uruk-hai left and right as they come at him. You know, takes like three arrows to the chest and still keeps fighting. You know,
this is true. This is all true.
And even with all of that, he still lives long enough for Aragorn and him to make peace.
Yeah. And isn't he able to tell Aragorn, you know, that the halflings ran, or Frodo was safe?
No, he told Aragorn that they basically have Merry and Pippin, I think.
Yeah, that's yeah. It's a shame that we had such a strong character as Boromir only in the first movie. How incredible is that?
It is, but that again, that's still in necessary. Line with the story.
Yeah.
I mean, they had some good scenes like early in the journey when he's like trying to teach the hobbits how to use swords and he accidentally smacks one in the hand and like three of them jump him and everything. And, you know, they're kind of all chuckling as they're on this, you know, hilltop before they have to hide from the flock of evil birds. You know, mm-hmm. Boromir is a man who is trying to protect his people. And he's been, you know, it's almost like he's got some PTSD, you know, seen a lot of his countrymen fall. He's a soldier, but he's a man who's been fighting a long time.
This is true.
And I think his faith in everything is waning. And I think that's where a lot of the problem is. Like I said, you said he's vulnerable. I say he's starting to become desperate. And of course, he's also dealing with the pressure of having to lead the forces of Gondor and whatnot. And poor Faramir is doing everything his dad asked, is getting treated like shit the whole time. And he is the more thoughtful and maybe more reserved of the brothers. You know, yeah. But he's no less
talented.
Yep, and he's no less
good of heart.
Dedicated.
Yeah, he's dedicated. Just honorable.
He's not dad's favorite. It sucks, you know.
And that's probably what gave him the drive, you know, when you think about it. That's probably what left Boromir so vulnerable to the temptations of the ring, because he was dad's favorite.
There's a lot of pressure on him.
Right. Whereas for Faramir, he felt the pressure of the ring. But he's like, no, you need to have that. That's yours. Go. He didn't fall anywhere close to the temptation that Boromir did.
Well, Samwise set him straight.
Well, yeah, but still, I mean, it didn't take, you know, didn't Boromir like get a stone to the head or something like that? And then he's like, Frodo, I'm sorry.
Well, you know, Frodo hides and like ends up like scrambling out from under him, you know, with the ring. And I don't know. And then like the moment hits him, he gets a moment of clarity and he realizes what he's done.
Good times.
Well, they're all fascinating. You do get, even though you see like Legolas and Gimli more, I think Legolas seems to have like the least character development of anybody.
No character in the books. He had zero character in the books. There was nothing. He was just a cardboard cutout of an elf. That's it. In the movies, he at least had, you know, some sense of humor. And that's what I wanted to point out. There was humor in these movies that was not in the books.
Well, that makes sense.
And that was well
modern
done.
Audience.
Yeah, that was well done. I liked the back.
Nobody tosses a dwarf.
Yeah. I love that partnership between Legolas and Gimli.
Well, they start off on the wrong foot, and they finally, you know, not only make peace, you know, and then they get into this very gruesome competition.
Yeah, they're counting the number of bodies they each take down. And I will say the once and only time that I ever stood up and clapped in a movie theater in the middle of the movie was during Legolas taking down the Oliphant.
It still only counts as one.
It still only counts as one. And it ends with that. Gimli goes, he tears him down to, that's only one. It's like, my friend and I that were in the theater, he and I looked at each other like, we nodded just silently. We didn't say anything. We nodded. I'm like, And we both just stood up and just started clapping when he took that Oliphant down. I mean, there was no other way you could go about it, right? It deserved it.
it was great. I mean, I think maybe one of the best scenes in the entire trilogy, though, was the charge of the Rohirrim. The recently departed Bernard Hill was great as Theoden.
Yeah, agreed. And Gondor calls. And Rohan.
Gondor calls for aid.
And Rohan will answer. there's a moment in Stargate where they're trying to communicate to the Pegasus Galaxy, and they can't really do it unless they have relay systems that send the signal faster than the speed of light. And so the head scientist is like sitting there trying to brainstorm how to get the signal to the Pegasus Galaxy for their base over there. And he stops, he goes, the Midnight Bark. And then everyone's like, what? The Midnight Bark, 101 Dalmatians? You know, doesn't anyone have children here? And he stops, he goes, hold on. Lord of the Rings, guys. And everyone's like, oh yeah, we set off the fire beacons. I always thought that had me laughing out loud when that moment happened. But that's how ingrained the Lord of the Rings movies were to society at that moment, you know? So.
Oh my God, yes. I mean, they did. There was parodies and not tip of the hat. And I mean, well, and for me, you know, at the time that these movies were coming out, what else was coming out? The Harry Potter movies, right?
Yeah. You know, which you...
This one spoke to me more.
Well, you didn't answer at all to Harry Potter.
I know.
So, would you say that they even spoke to you?
The Lord of the Rings did speak to me. Harry Potter didn't. And that's fine. You know? But you have such fantastic storytelling, and Peter Jackson really crushed these three movies, you know, start to finish. I mean, and of course, The Return of the King, it looks like it has like four endings because the book has like eight, you know.
That's how it is. Like, so when Frodo and Sam and the other two get back, the Shire is taken over by another clan. Like, not, but not, they were taken over by elements ruffians. Of Saruman. Yeah, ruffians, yes, and whatnot.
Read by Saruman and Wormtongue. The battle of, or the scouring of the Shire. That's what it was.
Yeah, that's what, so, like, they
get
a
little
hint
of it in that, in the
flash forward
that Frodo gets.
Yeah.
If the ring fell to Sauron. And it's right. Sam and Hobbits.
I was expecting to see that, but I was thinking, like, how are they going to fit that in? And then when I saw that they didn't, I'm like, okay, I'm fine with that. It felt overwrought and unnecessary, even in the book. I mean, it showed Sam being a hero.
The whole movie, the whole trilogy shows Sam being a
hero.
But
in front of the Shire, like the Shire got to learn who Samwise could be. And it was, I think it was Sam that cast them away. But that being said, fine. I remember the audience in the movie theater chuckling with every false ending that happened and a new ending came up. And as we saw Sam go into his hut with his family, and it says the end.
His real
wife
and daughter, I think, right?
His real daughter. I don't know about his wife. I it could be his wife.
It was his real daughter, yes. I can't remember if that was his wife or not.
Yeah, I don't know about that. But I remember the audience, like, they chuckled after the first two false endings, which are not false. It was just part of the book. They weren't endings. They were wrap-ups, you know?
They could have been endings if you wanted to.
They could have been, but it was a more complete ending if you had those other wrap-ups in there. So,
mm-hmm.
But I'm sitting here like, did no one do the reading here, people? Like, this is how it works. Like,
am I the only one who did the reading last night?
Yeah. So, Avengers. A nice callback too, by the way. It brought me back to my college days when he said,
proposal.
Am I the only one who did the reading? The proposal. Oh, yeah, I could fourth wall break too. The proposal.
Look.
What the shit? That's not how that works.
If I had to nitpick anything from Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings, is that, you know, at times I feel it was too good.
I work too hard. That's my failing. Yeah. I care too much.
I really don't have much in the way of nitpicks. Most of the external information I have built up since I've watched the movies only makes me understand the situation it's in more. So I cannot fault the movies for lack of information that I had going in, right? I walked into the first movies having seen a bunch of cartoons when I was a kid and not really understanding the whole gist of The Lord of the Rings, okay?
Yeah.
So.
So how'd you know
I
what
loved
you knew?
It. Oh, here's the downside. All the spiders. Fucking hate it. I know it's in the book.
There's only one spider.
Well, and I'm also talking of it.
Yeah.
Oh, bleh. I literally sat for that whole 5-minute scene not looking at the screen. I am not ashamed to say it. It was just, it was nightmare fuel.
There's been a preponderance of spiders in the gaming world lately, too. The Harry Potter, oh God, the Harry Potter Wizarding World or whatever has a bunch of spiders everywhere that you have to fight. And there's another game too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I forgot what it was. Anyway, hey, but there's been a preponderance of spiders lately. Giant spiders. Giant-ass spiders.
Apparently.
Oh, like, Jedi Fallen Order.
The Mandalorian.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, God. I can't watch that to this day.
You know what we didn't get in the... That I'm not disappointed we didn't get in the Battle of Winterfell and the Longest Night episode of Game of Thrones was that, you know, they even mention it in earlier episodes where they talk about, oh, the legends of the White Walkers who rode on on ice spiders the size of ponies. And like,
Rick, no, really? Yeah. Thank God for budget constraints, man.
I have this huge book, The World of Ice and Fire, which is all illustrations of the greater world. And there is a picture of a White Walker on an ice spider, a drawing. I'm like, nope, glad we didn't get that. And if they did, we didn't see it.
Mm-hmm.
Hell no. I mean, and that's just a personal issue for me. I can't fault it. It's part of the story, but that was just a nope for me. Straight up nope.
Yeah. Yeah,
and that's Return of the King is still a near perfect movie in my mind, and that includes an entire scene I wouldn't watch.
Shelob, this whole Shelob scene happened in the Two Towers, in the book, and I was really nervous on how they were going to play that off, but the CGI for that spider was really well done. I mean, yeah, freaky nightmare.
I couldn't tell you how good it was.
Freaky nightmare fuel. Like this. But it moved like a spider, man. It moved like a spider, and it was quiet, and it was believably quiet, like when it moved all stealthily and stuff. So,
yeah.
I know.
I don't have enough Chimay to go too much deep into this.
And then the fangs go. Oh, by the way, Frodo gets stabbed for a third time. So, yeah.
I guess it can go through mithril.
I don't know what happened. I mean, it's not like Mithril's like waterproof, so.
Yep, that was just a big nope. Nope. But
anyway, on that note, everybody, come on. And on a happier note, we got to wrap this up.
For me, it's probably as close to a perfect trilogy as, for me, as The Lord of the Rings, the original trilogy of Star Wars are right there, you know? I mean, I will say consistency across the board, Lord of the Rings has Star Wars beat, you know, even in the original trilogy, because Empire upped the game so much.
Yeah.
But start to finish, from Kate Blanchett intro to Sam coming into the Shire and lifting up his daughter. Start to finish. Fantastic. You know, and you have these Americans, you know, putting on a couple of them putting on decent non-American accents. At times, I think Aragorn or Viggo Mortensen's accent got a little too American. But I didn't care. It's just something I noticed.
Let it pass, you know?
I mean, you have people who've made huge careers out of this movie, like, I mean, Elijah Wood was a child star, but this showed, you know, that he had grown, you know. I mean, he did some heavy shit when he was young.
The Good Son.
Whew. Yeah, that was a fucked up movie, too.
He did the movie Forever Young with Mel Gibson.
Yeah, he did a lot of stuff when he was young. But this helped him grow from being a child actor to an act, you know, to a adult actor taking adult roles. Sean Astin really upped his game for this. Not that he had not done it before, but you know, the boost it gave to careers of Billy Boyd and Dominic Monaghan. Dominic Monaghan ended up on Lost. You know, I mean, huge boost to these guys. These guys, you know, all of these guys can crush at conventions for the rest of their lives because of this.
Yeah. Yeah. Completely.
For Sean Bean, it was just another dead guy he got to play. But that still upped his visibility.
We bled the same blood in the same mud or something like that.
It's still upped his visibility. But then you get people like Orlando Bloom, who blew up with this and Pirates at the same time.
Yeah, that's right. Well, and Pirates then, came right before the last movie came out. He was on his way. He was sailing. Yeah.
This helped Carl Urban.
Yeah.
It's like I'm drawing a blank right now. Elrond.
Oh, Agent Smith. Red Skull. I don't know his name,
Hugo Weaving.
Yeah, there it is.
Hugo Weaving, who's in everything. You know, he was in Star Trek. Wait, what? No, I wasn't. I'm sorry. No. he was in Avengers. He was not in Avengers. The Matrix.
He was in Captain America.
Well, I mean, he's in the MCU.
Okay.
So, and yeah, he wasn't actually, but the Red Skull was in the
Red Skull was in Avengers, but it wasn't him.
But he's one of those guys you're like, I want a guy to either be a bad guy or a cool dude, you know, let's do that, V for Vendetta. I mean, Hugo Weaving, that's a guy. Carl Urban, that's it. I want somebody in one of the, in a sci-fi or fantasy, let's get this guy, right? Carl Urban, this really kind of gave him a lot of room to start starring and shit, you know?
I don't think he ever got better than his role as Caesar, Julius Caesar in Xena.
Jeez, I gotta be honest with you. Really stretching.
I gotta be honest with you.
Really stretching.
That was a tour de force. It was a tour de force. Probably one of the greatest, the greatest roles of any television actor ever. It was just amazing. Like, oof. Gives my heart a flutter.
Stop. Just stop. He was probably the one closest to his counterpart, to the predecessor in Star Trek 09. In the Kelvin universe.
He resurrected DeForest Kelly.
Yeah. He nailed that. And he was like, him and Simon Pegg were the only ones who didn't have somebody to talk to about it either.
This is true.
But that being said, it made careers for these guys. The sad thing is for Peter Jackson, his career could only go down from here.
Yeah, well, he did King Kong right afterwards, which I thoroughly enjoyed. I saw that in the movie theater, and I was blown away.
I'm sure it was a popcorn fair, right?
It was an amazing ride, and it made King Kong look very sympathetic. Like you saw. Sure. Did you ever see it?
No.
Do not tell me you didn't see it.
I'm not a big fan of the monster movies.
I've seen a few of them. It was a tragedy.
The original was a tragedy.
Yeah, this was better conveyed.
I'm sure. I'm just saying.
It was a very good film that he followed up the Lord of the Rings with.
And then he did Jack Black.
Jack Black was in it, yep. Adrian Brody, Colin Hanks. Colin Hanks was in it. Naomi Smith, Naomi Watts. Anyway, we got to wrap things up. So I will tell you one little anecdote about this, and then we're going to give grades. So after I saw the first movie in the theater, we're out in the lobby and we're all talking about it, because this is the first time me and my group of friends had all seen it, except one. A random woman, probably in her late 30s, early 40s, just comes walking up, and they're like, "Oh, is this your first time seeing this movie?" And I'm like, "Yeah, yeah, it was interesting." And they're like, she's like, "Did you ever read the books?" And I'm like, "No, I haven't." So I'm a little confused by a couple things. And she goes, "Oh, you need to read the books. This movie was so faithful to the books. It was so enjoyable to watch as a Tolkien fan." And I'm like, "Oh, okay, that's very high praise that I have to take into account." And because of that woman who remains in my memory to this day, I went out and bought the books over at Providence Place Mall, and then started reading. And I was very happy to see that they had the bag of heads scene in the Return of the King, where they launched the net of Gondor's heads, Gondor soldiers' heads, and there
released the prisoners.
Yeah, yeah, it was freaking dark, and I'm like, "Oh, they won't have this in the movie. I hope they do, though." And then they did, and I'm like, "Oh, I really wish they didn't do that, because I see it now." So, that being said, I will have to say, any misgivings that I had about these movies was due to pure ignorance, right? I mean, sure. Fully and acknowledge that. There were some things that needed to be cut, but I felt that all the cuts were super healthy and super well done and necessary to bring these movies to life on the silver screen. So that being said, I'm going to give this trilogy an A+.
Same. Can't argue with it. A+. So. Oscar winners. Fantastic storytelling. Great acting. The music was spectacular. Cinematography, oh,
Howard
everything.
Shore, fantastic, yes. Can't get better than that.
Ironically enough, the very first time I heard Get Your Ticket was on a Middle Earth podcast.
So you stole the idea.
I just found a song I liked.
Are we going to get a cease and desist here? We're already getting copyright notices because of this song.
Dude, so. this the last time I saw even any of these videos was like 4 years ago, so I think we're okay.
Oh, you think so? Okay. Well, on that note, everybody, any farewells you want to give DT?
Look, it's our 200th episode. I couldn't be prouder. I'm so happy. I hope that you all have enjoyed this ride, and please know that we are going strong and we want to continue going forward. So thank you for everybody who's been with us on this ride, and show your support, and we'll continue to put out this stuff. Okay. Thank you so much. And my friend, happy 200th.
Happy 200th. I am P.S. McKay. That's the ultimate end. We are those sci-fi guys. It's out there.
And I'm DT Calfman. And up on the high ground, there's no Dark Lord and there's endless Chimay.
Sci-Fi Guys is an independent broadcast by Alpha Site Productions, produced by DT Cabman and P.S. McKay. Music courtesy of Camtasia. For more information on upcoming episodes, follow P.S. McKay on X at P.S. McKay, or go to thosci-fi-guys.com for past episode information. You can find us on YouTube with live video podcasts and Facebook. Be sure to leave a like and a comment and let us know how we're doing.